wanted to talk about today, and I appreciate all of you making the time to be here, is kind of my approach and the ACM's approach to faculty development, and some of the things that have been informed both by some research that I ended up doing in a parallel track, and working in this environment with 14 small liberal arts colleges in 5 states. So the ACM is in Illinois, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Colorado, and Iowa. So we have a pretty broad reach. I wanted to start off, and let's hope the technology works. I wanted to start off by asking this question. And I know I didn't give you an I don't know option because I want to force you to make a decision, if at all possible. I'd like you to rank these 3 things. And if the technology does fail, we'll just do a show of hands. But if you go to pollev.com and then edfin086, you can get this started. And this will come back. I'll have 2 questions for you, and then we'll talk about it as we go through the presentation. So we'll give it just a second to start and see if anything comes up.
And EduRome is a network.
Is anybody able to log in? We can do it the old fashioned.
Yes.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure because I didn't want to. So while this is populating, talking a little bit, my role is a long title at the ACM called Liaison for Innovation and Collaboration in Teaching and Learning. So it's a lot to say. But what it entails is going around to all 14 campuses twice a year. So I don't know if they're still busy.
You need the I don't know section.
Or all of the above.
All of the above. Right, right. There is an all of the above in the real world, hopefully. But if you had to prioritize, what would it be? Or what would it be in order? Maybe you're going to do all of the above, but what would you need to do first would be the question.
Responded, but I don't see it.
But it's not sure.
You might have to watch
okay.
3 questions.
Yeah, it's
F5.
What?
Press F5.
Okay, we're going old school. because I don't want to slow us down. So let's just start at the top. And who believes that the first thing we should do is providing an effective encouragement, providing encouragement, support, and continuing education? Okay, creating and communicating a compelling vision when you're leading change. Wow. So majority of them, and involving faculty in the decision-making process. So I'd say we got a close, almost tie for these as the first one. We won't go through second and third just because I don't want to slow us down. So now let's try one other question, and this one don't even try to do online. Let's just talk about it. Do you feel your input, now this is whether if you're in a faculty role or if you're in a staff role, technology role, whatever that would be, do you feel your input is valued when purchasing new technologies? Yes? What about no? Okay, so majority yes, so that's good. Okay, so let's talk about what we're going to talk about. Don't worry, I'm not going to take you through my dissertation. I wouldn't wish that on anybody. I never want to read it again. But there are some things in it that I think inform the way we talk about faculty development and the way that we talk about working with colleges who traditionally are the in-person environment, who do that very well and have done it for hundreds of years. Then we're going to talk about kind of the ACM model, what my position actually does. Of my grant role that I have, because I'm in the faculty development and grants department, and also my circuit writing, which it took me a while to catch on to that term, but I kind of like it, because I really am gone a lot, and I am on these campuses having conversations with different people. So very quick research. I did a case study of 9 faculty members looking at their perceptions of the change of an implementation of a new learning management system. 9 different disciplines, 2 schools in the Midwestern urban campus. So kind of a variety of people using technology in different places, doing different things with it, but they had the commonality of going through a new adoption of a learning management system. Now, the themes that that developed out of this, and what I did was I took, I used 2 change theories, John Cotter and Black and Gregerson. One looks at group change, one looks at individual change. And then I funneled that through an instrument to find themes, and then it was qualitative after that. What I found is the main themes, number one, and these are in no particular order, but faculty commitment level. So are faculty committed to making a change or doing something different with the way they teach or using a new system that they may have been familiar with the old system? Leadership structure and encouragement. Do leaders encourage faculty to take this leap? Do they encourage them to do new and innovative things? And is there a structure in place? You know, is this just coming from the president's office, or is this also coming from the deans and the chairs, and everyone is talking on the same page? Faculty involvement and pedagogy. So getting faculty involved to talk about not only what this system can do, but what it needs to do, and how it informs the way they teach in their classrooms. Providing a support and communication structure to get feedback from faculty, but also to have them supported to do new things in the classroom with different technologies. And professional development, which is can be part of support and communication, but it's much more targeted in thinking about new ways to think through problems that are associated with technology. Not necessarily tools, but approaches. So the research findings real fast. Findings, create and communicate a compelling vision, which was the first one that was identified here. What do you have to get in front of faculty to make them really think about going in a different direction when what they've been doing works, or at least works for the most part, and in some cases works very well? They have these kids in person, and they're going through these exercises, and they're talking about their topics. They're experts in what they do, and we're saying, well, let's reimagine that and think about it. Involving faculty in the decision-making process, getting them in early to talk about that. And then providing encouragement, support, and continuing education. Now, the recommendations, we won't go through each one. These slides are available I uploaded them and hope they're there. It said it was under review, so I don't know if I did something wrong. But one of the main things to begin with, the first two I think are the most important, which is adopting some kind of a framework to make a change happen. So thinking through whether you're going to go at it from an individual perspective, a group perspective, or whether you're going to go at it in a combination of those two. But something that works at your institution culturally. And then involving faculty early and often, getting them into the process and talking about what ways can we make changes, what are things you're already doing that we may not be aware of. One thing I found out was that a lot of times faculty are using things, they're kind of going off the grid, and they're using a free version of Canvas when their institution has Moodle. Or they're using Google Hangouts for something that they want to do when you may have Zoom. Just different things out there, and pulling that in and having that discussion about why. Why do you do it this way? Okay, so real fast, and as I said, I'm in the faculty development and grants, and my position was established by a Mellon grant, and is sustainable after the grant. So I actually phase into the AC full-time this year. But what it does is a $2 million grant. It included 2 things. The grant funding for the campuses to be able to play and do different things and innovate, and also the position of me to go around and kind of facilitate those conversations. So to talk to different people about what that means. It has 4 main components. One is address the liberal arts challenge. So if faculty are going to apply for a grant, they need to address a challenge on a liberal arts campus. It's interdisciplinary and or multi-campus. Some include all 14 schools. Some include, and that could be one discipline from 14 different schools. Some include five or six or eight disciplines from one institution, or a combination of that. And then they ask, what is going to be disseminated from this? You know, are you going to just share it with the consortium? And what we found is, yes, they share it with the consortium, but a lot of conference presentations then come out of this, a lot of white papers, a lot of broader sharing of knowledge among the higher education community about what's going to happen. And then the last thing is sustainability. We're going to give this money, and the Mellon Foundation had used the model of my position, which was, you're going to stay. That's the commitment when we write this grant. And so we asked them the same thing. What components? Not everything. We know that obviously you need grant money for a reason. But what components are going to stay? So what are the things that you're going to be able to carry forward? Whether it's new ways of faculty thinking about their pedagogy, whether it's incorporating the technology that you got it for part of this purchase into your normal life cycle, all of these different things that a lot of times aren't thought about, and it's kind of a one and done. So now we get to talk to the fun part of my job, which is really the best part, which is riding around on the circuit. So this is just a few of the groups that I meet with on a regular basis when I'm on a campus. It's usually a full day. Faculty, administration, IT, which sometimes includes the, it's hard to figure out where to put them as far as the technologists, because some of them are in the library, some of them are in IT, and some of them are reporting to the dean. But they, I put them here just to kind of be, you know, a little strategic in that. And the same with Center for Teaching and Learning and that kind of thing under the libraries. And then I typically, if they do exist, some of our campuses don't have foundations people on their campus because they are small. I'll meet with them, and then I'll meet with career services as well. In some cases, not all campuses, not all equally. It all depends on what that individual culture calls for. Now, it sounds like a lot, and it is. But it doesn't all start and stop on that one day. I mean, have you ever had someone come in from an organization and they're there for a day and then you don't hear from them for ever? That's not me. You'll usually, there are constant streams of emails, there are constant things going on. There are conversations that begin, not just because I was on a campus, but because someone else emails a different person who knows me, and then we start talking. And we get people involved from all 14 campuses. One thing that is really interesting is kind of the organic nature of this, and that's why I mentioned the research real fast. The organic nature of faculty development is that, yes, I have money that right now we've done 32 grants over 4 years and about $500,000 in grants to the 14 schools. But there have also been new things that have come about just because of the conversations, with no money at all, with no trying out, or with no support in some cases. Sometimes it's just faculty getting together and deciding that they really want to do something cool, and they really want to do something different. One thing that was two people that I introduced my first week on the job, of all things, ended up doing a course on religion and hate and religion, when religion turns violent. One is a biblical scholar and one is an Islamic studies scholar. And they said, let's look historically, let's do this online. Let's do this through Zoom, but not through, you know, the big still shot of here's the whole class and then here's the whole class. Let's have everybody have their own individual accounts, and we'll make it really personal and really involved. And we'll also throw in some discussions to draw out those people who may not speak otherwise, and then we'll have an in-person component at the end. And let's try it first on alumni. So let's try it there, and then let's bring it into the curriculum. Well, they're teaching that first actual combined course at two campuses in the fall. So I had nothing to do with that except, have you met this person? And I think it's really cool that those are the kinds of conversations that grow out of this type of work. So, as a final way of talking about that, that idea of this organic growth, this is the grant that I primarily work with. But since then, we've also had other funding for looking at the economics of higher education, which I presented on last year here with some of my colleagues. We've looked at enhancing the Midwest Knowledge Ecosystem, which actually targeted less commonly taught languages. So looking at, you know, how to teach language with technology in new and innovative ways. We also have a grant that looks at, and this is our, it's a very long title, but to diversify the professoriate, it's actually got two pieces. One, it filters undergraduate students from our campuses into the Big Ten to be able to have summer research opportunities and encourage them to go to graduate school. And then on the other side, it brings in and provides funding for new faculty hires for underrepresented populations. And then, of course, this one, I guess I should put it up there. The ICF, which was on economics, was so well received that we did an online version using adaptive learning. So there's a lot, and then the last one is SAIL, which is the Advanced Interdisciplinary Learning, which includes everything from technology components, where they went to Silicon Valley and looked at how to innovate in the classroom more, to looking at boundary waters and looking at ecological, how to incorporate ecology into the classroom. So I tried to condense all that down the best I could, but this is me. Do you have any questions?